Welcome back to episode 11 of Blowin' Wind with the Great Southern Brain Fart. Yes, this one goes to 11, and this time around we're going to talk to legendary shock rocker Lizzy Borden. Inspired by such psychodrama acts as Alice Cooper and Kiss, Lizzy Borden hit the LA metal scene delivering an over-the-top stage show that made Wasp look like Warrant at times. If you don't believe me, just go find the Murderous Metal Roadshow on YouTube and you'll see what I'm talking about. But anyway, that aside, many years later and many lineups changes later, Lizzy Borden is back with his first album of new material in a long fucking time, and it couldn't have come at a better time. The album is called My Midnight Things, and I had the opportunity to talk to the Murderous himself from his home in Las Vegas. We talked about the Murderous Metal Roadshow live album from the 80s, their breakout performance in the Decline of the Western Civilization Part 2, The Metal Years, and how fucking pumped he is to be back at his home label, Metal Blade, and to be hitting the road with a whole new production that is definitely going to take things over the top and to a level that Lizzy Borden himself has never been to. I hope you guys and gals all enjoy this episode of Blowin' Wind with the Great Southern Brain Fart featuring the legendary Lizzy Borden. Lizzy Borden, I have to tell you, it is an honor to talk to you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, before I get started too long, I have to say, like most guys my age, or most people my age, my first introduction to Lizzy Borden was The Decline of the Western Civilization Part 2, The Metal Years. When that movie came out, I just remember the three things that my friends and I all said about that movie. Was it, well, let's make it four. Was it Chris Holmes is never going to survive? Odin will never make it. Seduced is good. Lizzy Borden is the best fucking band on the planet, and they should be fucking huge. So,
I love that.
I mean, you know, but like looking back on that, does it blow your fucking mind that it has been 32 years? It's been 32 years since you put out Murderous Metal Roadshow, which was like my first Lizzy album.
Yeah, it's mind-blowing, the whole thing, because you know, who knows, you know, the music industry has gone in so many different directions, and that movie it was going to be the celebration of what was happening, this gold rush that happening in, you know, in this one piece of the world. And it was very different than what happened in Seattle, because no one rushed to Seattle. I mean, but everyone came to Hollywood to be a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the original intention behind the movie. And then she saw this dark underbelly of about all these delusional people that were not looking at it in a professional way. They were looking at it as a dream that they had to obtain, otherwise, you know, they were going to end their lives, you know, or whatever. So when she saw that, she kind of switched her the way she directed the movie. But it was cool. I mean, I love it. And right now, when we go play Europe, and our audience is very young around the world,
uh-huh.
Other than North America, it's all very young. And they love that movie, and they don't see that. They do see the celebration of that time, and that's the thing that they like. So, yeah, it's a mind blower.
Because it's really interesting, like how you brought that up, because I'm sure that's one of the things you get asked the most, like when when you're doing interviews. Like, do you ever get sick of talking about it, or like, because if you do, you can be like, dude, I'm gonna kick you in the nuts if we say anything more about it. You know, like.
And I'm doing press for an album. I mean, you know, they're going to, most people just go across my career and find the things that they think is interesting to ask me about. And sometimes it's the same stuff and sometimes it's different. But It's all good. I mean, you know, I know what I'm doing here. I'm promoting my midnight things, and I'm talking about my career. So it's not a horrible thing.
Well, that's cool to hear, because, you know, like, I've talked to a lot of bands, and some bands say, oh, if I have to hear this question again, da da da. And then some bands are just like, you know what? I never mind talking about it, because it's a part of, you know, it was a stepping stone. It was a part of what got me to where I am now and whatnot, you know? So that's cool that you have that outlook on it, you know? But just to not to dwell on it too much more, though, but looking at this movie so many years later, when was the last time that you watched it? And when you watched it, did you look at yourself and say, that's exactly how I wanted it to be presented at that moment? Because I personally thought you came off as a real professional. You know what I mean? Like, that was the thing that impressed me the most. That was the thing that sent me out buying a Lizzy Borden album, you know, and why I couldn't care less about the other bands. You know what I mean? You know, 'cause I was like, this dude's serious. Like, this dude's like, you know, really into it. Like, this is a thing. I need to go support this guy. Do you know what I mean? Like, so do you look back on it now and go, that's how I wanted to be presented, and I'm happy with that?
Well, I'm certainly happy about the reaction that you got from it. that's exactly what I would have wanted, you know. Yeah, I don't look back on it and go and cringe. You know, I haven't seen the movie in years. I don't even know the last time I saw it, but I don't look back and cringe. I think I said everything that I meant, and it wasn't, you know, I don't look back and go, oh, God, what did I say then? But so I think I'm all right with it. You know, I'm all right with our part in the movie. There's actually so much more that she filmed that is in a cutting room area somewhere, and we actually tried to get some of the footage because she shot our whole show. And we were going to use some of that footage, but whoever put that movie out, I forget what Paramount or whatever, right, put it out. You can't get it from them. It's just impossible. So, but there's a full live show that she shot, which was an amazing show that we did. And one day it would be a miracle to get that footage, but. Yeah, I had a great time filming that movie.
We'll have to hop the fences or something, man. You know what I mean? And, like, go, like, storm the vaults or something. Where was that show filmed anyway? I always wanted to ask you that. What venue was that performance filmed in?
It was Van Halen's old hometown, Pasadena, and they used to play this place all the time, Perkins Palace.
Oh, and okay, yeah.
It was a great venue, and it used to be the king until everyone wanted to move closer to Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And then so Hollywood kind of ruled forever. But Pasadena was about 35 minutes away, and that was such a great venue, and it was an honor to play there just because of the nature of that place and all the people that have played there and done stuff there. So to have that movie filmed there was perfect.
See, and it really captured the whole essence of your live show, because, again, what was so funny was that the first album that I was actually able to obtain, like, or that I really went for right after seeing that movie, was the Murderous Metal Road Show, obviously, which was, you know, I mean, I had the VHS tape of that, and I've still got the double album. I'm looking at it right now, because that was actually filmed at the Country Club, and I remember when you guys did Psychopath on that album, my dad, like, is watching it with me, and I'm like, hiding my face, and he leans in at me, he goes, don't tell your mom you have this. And I'm like, okay, you know, we're cool. So, you know. But, like, that to me is such an iconic live album that I don't feel like it ever got its due as being such a, like, a live staple of heavy metal. But nowadays it's weird. It's like I'm hearing more and more people bring it up. Like, do you start to hear more of your past being brought up now, especially now that you're making this kind of comeback too with the new album and everything? Like, all of a sudden I'm hearing your name a lot more frequently than I was, you know, even 5 years ago.
Well, that's what happens when you release a new album. People start talking about, you know, the longevity of it and their album, the one that they got around that time. And the album that I get mostly is Master of Disguise because it was the biggest selling record.
Right.
But I have been getting a few Murderous Metal Roadshow here and there. And I know when I go to different markets, you know, you never know what albums are going to come for you to sign. And sometimes they bring the whole catalog, and sometimes they bring, you know, different ones. So it's it changes for territory. But, when you put out an album and you're doing press and everything, people will start talking about, you know, the first album they got, you know.
Yeah, because, you know... One of the things that struck me the most, too, is that the fact that, you know, I mean, you started this in 1983. And so, of course, you're talking, like, right on the cusp of everything that was happening on the Sunset Strip and in Hollywood at the time. You know, you're talking, like, you know, what was it? Like, you know, Wasp was putting out their debut, you know, Crew, Rat, you know, everybody. Like, was Lizzy Borden always your visual concept from the get-go, or was that something that kind of came in when you saw everything that was going on in Hollywood and said, we've got to do something to stand out?
Well, for me, the first concert I had ever seen, I was 15, I saw Kiss. Mm-hmm. And that was it. That was it for me. I knew that that's what I wanted to do, and I wanted to invent a character. I knew I wanted to do... resembling what they were doing, you know, and so that was kind of my blueprint.
Right.
Even like the banners on the stage at that time, no one did that. Everyone was mimicking Van Halen at the time, and they had empty cabinets on all over. But I just said, why am I promoting Marshall amps? I don't get that. So I had banners created with the logo on there, so I was promoting Lizzy Borden, and now every band does it, but I was the first to do it because no one, and I didn't, it just didn't make any sense that I was promoting Marshall, and
especially when they're empty.
Yeah, especially when they're empty, only one working cabinet, the whole bunch. But Van Halen was so huge at the time, so they were just kind of mimicking what they saw. Mm-hmm. But I saw Kiss, and when I saw Destroyer, they had you couldn't see any of the cabinets. I was like, that's a show. So that's the first thing I did, was cover up the mechanics of the show, the mechanics of the working parts, and create that show. And like I said, now every band does that. And it's so at the beginning, yeah, I did. There wasn't anybody to copy, really, because everybody was kind of, you know, if I was copying anybody, it would have been Kiss and Cooper and Bowie and the Tubes. It wasn't what was currently playing there, because most bands didn't have a following. I mean,
right.
Metallica played in front of like three people the time I saw them, uh-huh. And Wasp was playing in front of the same amount, but we all kind of grew very fast, and the fan base started to happen really for all of us really quickly. But as far as the theatrics, yeah, I was mimicking what I was growing up on with the Tubes and Cooper, Bowie, and Kiss, and a few others.
Because I love that, because there's so many different elements to especially to the classic Lizzy Borden sound, you know, where, like, you know, even now, you know, at 44, when I go back and I listen to, Council for the Cauldron, like, it's as exciting now as it was in 86 when I heard it. Do you know what I mean? Because it still clicks with me as far as, like, wow, it still sounds like the stuff that I loved, you know? But it you know, and the other thing, too, is, like, I see so many of these younger bands that are coming out now, the younger metal bands, and you just look at them, and there's zero effort to their stage production. And then I go back, and I look at, like, what you guys were doing on the same size stages that these bands are playing, and I'm going, come on, guys, just go look at the back of a Lizzy Borden record or a Wasp record and, like, get an idea. Do you know what I mean? Do something to like, you know, I don't want to just look at your half stacks, you know? Like, I want to see... a show, you know what I mean? Like,
well, the difference is, and it's kind of an obvious difference, is there's performers and then there's musicians.
Right.
And even if someone has a gigantic production and they just kind of walk around, they're still not a performer. They're just a musician, which is not a bad thing. It's awesome. But, the performers are, you know, they understand entertainment a little bit better. musicians just understand, watch me play my instrument. And so those two things, sometimes they don't gel into the same person. That's why I've always, you know, every lineup I've ever had, I search for people that are performers as well as musicians. I don't want a guy just standing there showcasing his skill. You know, it doesn't interest me. So I want people to be very interesting on stage, and that accentuates the production that you have. But, you know, I've seen bands with giant productions, and they still just musicians just standing there, and that's fine, too. It's a whole different animal, but it's the difference between performers and musicians.
You know, that's interesting. I never really put that together. I mean, because, you know, I mean, I play in, like, a roots rock band. I mean, obviously, it would look super weird if we had stairs and ramps and pyro. You know what I mean? But, like, you know, but, like, I get what you're saying. Though that there's, you know, there is that difference, but you found a way to kind of embody all of that, you know, into one. And if I remember correctly, Visual Lies was a pretty big album for you when that one came out, and I remember that one getting a lot of play on MTV. And then it's like you went away for a little while, and then you came back solo with Master of Disguise. What was it that led to that kind of decision? Because I remember watching an old interview with you and Adam Curry, which, by the way, I thought was hilarious, because I think that guy knew as much about metal as, you know, my mom does. But but you kind of touched base on that in an old interview where you're like, something kind of fell apart, and now I'm going to do this solo record. Did that change the impact of, like, where you, or the direction of where you thought it was going to go as far as, like, popularity or anything like that? Or at that point, were you just like, I just have to do what I have to do?
Well, Master of Disguise is the biggest record I've ever done. So
right.
It didn't really hurt me.
No, that's true. Yeah, that's very true. Yeah.
But at the same time, it's always been a solo band. I mean, if I have a lineup that I like, I'll promote it as a band. Mm-hmm. But it's never been a democracy. And I've had so many different lineups and so many different musicians. I had three bass players before we recorded the first EP. So, and then, you know, three guitar players before we recorded the next one. So, you know, other than Joey Scott, it's always been a solo thing. It's always been my vision. I write, even if I write a song with anybody else, it's usually a guitar player giving me a riff, and I'll take that riff and turn it into a song.
Right.
So, you know, I've never really written with another songwriter. So it's always been, I mean, I'm the one who put the first ad out, you know, looking for a bass player and guitar player for a theatrical rock band. So that was, you know, it was always my vision and I call the shots, basically.
Right.
But I didn't want to do it in a kind of authoritarian way. I just tried to find people that liked what I liked. So when I made decisions, no one balked, because they thought it was a good decision because they like what I like.
Right.
So, and you know, when it comes time where they no longer like what I like and they want what they want, then I just change the lineup into a different lineup, you know. So it's always been that way.
Well, I mean, but that's cool, because, I mean, if it's your vision, because I think that goes back to what you said kind of like about being a performer and being a musician. You know, there's also being, you know, being a leadership and being a democracy. You know what I mean? Like, some artists function better, you know, I mean, you know, like, look at Blackie Lawless. It's kind of like the same thing, right? You know, like, he's got a vision, and the minute somebody doesn't fit into that vision anymore, it's like, okay, you're either part of it or you're not. Okay, cool, thanks for playing, I appreciate it, you know.
Exactly.
You know, but that's cool, because I always wanted to know that about you, because I never really knew what it was that brought upon all of the different lineups of Lizzy Borden over the years.
Yeah, it's just, you know, people are in it all the way, they love everything that's going on, and then they start to veer off with their own influences and their own thoughts, and I say, that's fine, but do it somewhere else, you know. And that's why we just, you know, keep changing people up, and, you know, because I want to stay the course. I want to do what works for me.
Right.
And when it no longer works, then I just switch up the lineup, and it's actually refreshing too, because I've had at least two lineups in this band where I've had the best time in my life touring all over the world. And one was the Master of Disguise touring lineup, and one was the last one, or the one before the last one we did, which was the first couple legs of the anniversary tour that we did, and that lineup was amazing, and we had such a great time. Those two lineups were my favorite, and I wish they would have stayed around, but it just everyone has to go their separate ways, and that's the way it goes. And I knew, well, now I'm looking for a new lineup for the Midnight Things tour, and I'm sure it's going to be awesome, and I'm not going to pick anyone that I don't like. So,
<Right. laughs> I mean, you're going to have to live with these fuckers for a while, man. So they might as well.
And it's it brings in so much new stuff. You're not talking about stuff that you did, 30 years ago. You're talking about brand new stuff, that's happening now with the new lineup, and everyone's excited. And that bringing that excitement is really what it's all about. So every time I get a new lineup, it just brings all that energy in, and it makes it really exciting for, the 2 years that it usually does to tour around the world.
So, and speaking of touring, like how exciting is this, man? Like, you're putting out your first album in, like, what is it? Like, it's been 11 years or so? Like, am I right? It's about 11 years since Appointment with Death,
yeah.
I think. And,
yep.
Like, this has got to be an exciting time for you, because metal is really kind of, especially over the past 10 years or so, has experienced quite, like, a renaissance of sorts, not only with just classic acts, but with like new bands kind of uprising. So where does Lizzy Borden in 2018 kind of fit into all this with My Midnight Things? Because from what I've heard of the album, it is still very much Lizzy Borden, but like it is also very much like, move over, kids, let me show you how it's done. Done, what I mean? Which I loved, because I loved hearing that, in you. It doesn't sound like, oh, here's Lizzy Borden from 83.
That was one of the things I didn't want to do. I'm very not that, I don't pay attention to nostalgia that much.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always moving forward. And the new album, I'm when I go out and tour, I'm going to be playing the songs off the new album, and if there's any room left, then I'll play some of the older songs. But really, the whole point of touring is to promote the new album and to play the new album. So a lot of bands, they play one or two songs off their new album, but it's mainly about playing the hits or whatever. But I don't do that, and I've never done that. So that excitement level is really there too. But yeah, I don't think this album sounds like anyone on the planet, especially in 2018. And so that's the kind of thing you're hoping to do. Any band is hoping to do that. And I don't know how to explain what it is I do. It's just like, I don't know. I really don't know. But I'm glad that I do it, and I'm glad that there's not a lot of, I can't think of anyone that records albums the way I record them in this day and age anyway.
Well, can you go into that a little more? Like how so? Like how do you do these things? Or like what is it that you do that you feel like kind of sets you apart from the other ones?
I think bands in the 70s, certainly Queen, used to do it the way I did it, where you would record parts, you'd record the skeleton of a song, and then you fill it in. And, if I work with musicians, there's a trailer out for the new Queen movie, and he's telling Brian May, this is where the orchestra is going, or this is where the thing is going.
Right, I saw that, and I thought that was hilarious.
Yeah. But that's the way I record, and most people don't. Most people are bands, and they just jam, and they go do pre-production, and then they push record, and they go. I don't do it that way. I do it more like Queen, where I'm actually putting a skeleton together, and I'm filling in those slots with what I imagined that they could turn into. So that's the way I do it, and it's a unique way in the way people record, especially bands record. So, but it's, yeah, it's closer to Queen than anything else.
See, that's really cool, because that was one of the things that I always loved about Lizzy Borden albums, was that they especially, you know, Master, I mean, and of course, like Master Disguise, obviously, like you said, is your biggest album, but there's a reason for that, you know, like, you know, Visualize, I remember, was the album where, like, you know, Me Against the World came out, and a lot of my friends thought that song was great or whatever, but, like, Master Disguise, I remember thinking, like, that was where I started to really hear a lot of these, like, elements of recording, do you know what I mean? Like, there was, like, layers and things that it was a listening experience. Do you know what I'm saying? As opposed to just being like straight up raw twin guitar metal in your face. It was like an experience, and that seems to carry over with, especially with like Deal with the Devil and Appointment with Death. But like, you know, with my Midnight Things, I mean, I can imagine. Are you? You must be having a blast with technology at this point.
Yeah, I mean, even on Master's Guide, it was just, we got our first 8-track, and I just wrote and recorded by myself in a room for months, trying to figure out how to do it, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was an experience that taught me so much, because once I completed the demos, then I had something. It was different than being, you know, writing a song, you know, in my living room and then going to rehearsal and fleshing that song out with a band. It was a different experience, and I loved that experience. It was way more creative, and my imagination was just running wild in comparison to, you know, if I write a song really quickly and I go in with a band, you know, it's flushed out before I get a chance to really imagine it. And, you know, that's why we worked, that's why we had so many songs so quickly, because I would write them and we'd go to rehearsal and flesh them out, and that would be a song. We move on to the next song. And with doing it with technology and able to do it myself, my imagination is just set free. I'm able to do so much more.
And that's funny that you say that, because so many bands, you know, modern bands, have issues with technology where they talk about, like, oh, it takes away from this and it takes away from that. And I'm like, but God, man, how amazing is it? Like, even for, like, myself as a musician, that I can demo a song, I can upload it to Dropbox, my band can download it, listen to it, and then when we meet for rehearsal, they've got their parts written out. So we've already, like, saved like 5 hours worth of work, you know what I mean?
Just
by having that step, you know. So with
the thing that saves me is Joey Scott on drums. He's the one, his drums are, he's an old school drummer, so he plays with feel. So he doesn't play like a drum machine.
Uh-huh.
Like, you know, even real drummers, you know, that's what guitar players and bass players want. They just want a perfect timing behind them. And that strips the soul of a song. It makes it great to play if you're a guitar player or bass player, but it's not great to listen to.
Oh, because it's mechanical, you know. I mean, because part of what was so fun about that's why I don't like a lot of modern metal bands, because I feel like there's so much, you know, triggering and, you know, mechanics and click tracks and stuff, and it's like I miss that looseness and that kind of, like you said, that kind of old school feel to just the music.
Yeah. And that's the way he plays, and I, you know, I did not. It was very shorthanded when, you know, as far as tell him what the way I imagine these drums, because he already knew. He just listened to the song and it was like, okay, I know exactly what this needs. And so, you know, all that kind of moving drums, it moves the song in a real way, and it doesn't sound mechanical. And that was what I was going for. I didn't want to have, even though I'm playing most of the parts, I didn't want that. I don't want you to see the puzzle. I want you to flow, you know. And so that's the glue that actually held the whole thing together and made it sound real.
Well, so with that being said, like, you're going to embark on what I'm hoping is going to be a tour that's big enough to bring you to Atlanta. I don't even remember when was the last time you were in Atlanta, because I was probably not even old enough to get into the show where you play. I've never seen you live.
Yeah. We played, I think it was a place called Masquerade.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That was the place we used to play all the time. In fact, I had, like, 10 different wardrobes changes, and our crew, we were really thin on our crew, so they were on stage, and I'd have to run back to this thing and change my wardrobe there and come back on stage, and the Black Crows opened up for us. They're the only ones that had the key to the dressing room, and when I came back at the end, all my costumes were gone.
Oh, so, no!
I'm not saying they took it. I'm just saying they were the only other band, only other people to have the keys to the dressing room. So that's the thing I remember about playing the masquerade.
So this just might be the greatest story I've heard in a long time. Seriously, that the Black Crows potentially stole your costume. This is fantastic. I wish I knew those guys. I'd ask them.
Yeah, it was pretty funny.
Well, are there plans to really tour extensively behind My Midnight Things that'll hopefully bring you to places like Atlanta again after so many years?
Well, I mean, the last major tour we've done in North America was like 2014.
Right.
And we played, and then there's been a few tours right before that, too, across the U.S. But, right now, I wanted the album to come out first, and I wanted everyone to get used to the songs because there hasn't been an album in so long. So, and then I also wanted to do videos. Because that's a great format for me, especially. So the first one comes out tomorrow, and I'm excited about that. And then we're going to film the next few in the next few weeks. So those are things I kind of like thinking about right now, but I'm also working on the show.
Uh-huh.
So, right now the production that we're working on, it's going to be the biggest production we've had since Visualize Master of Disguise era. So I'm excited about that too. Yeah, it's a lot feasible now to do that stuff production wise and travel around the world with it than it used to be. It used to be impossible. We had during the Visualize tour, we had giant TV sets on that we came out of
right
on the tour. But when we went to Japan, it was impossible to ship our stage production there. So they've just built a new stage production for us in Japan.
I can't even have a logistical nightmare.
Yeah, it was. But now you don't have to do that. So now it's a lot better. So I'm planning on bringing the Midnight Things tour all around the world and excited to do it. But I am taking it very slow and we'll see as we go.
Yeah.
When I'll
start. Well, so one of the things I wanted to touch on too that you said something about is that, you love playing material from your new albums, which I think is such a great thing, and unfortunately a rare thing, because, you go see so many bands and, they have a new album and you get like two songs off the album, but then, obviously, dude, I'd love to hear all the Lizzy hits and everything, but, if I'm going to go see you, man, I want to hear you back your material. If you've got something new out, cash that check. Show me how proud of it you are.
If you believe in your record, you should play it.
Absolutely.
And I believe in this record, so I really want to play it. And it brings new life to me and the stage show and the whole thing. But I also do believe in the other side. I'm an entertainer and I want to entertain. I don't want people to yell out songs from the back catalog and never get their song played. But it's not a jukebox, I'm putting on the Midnight Things show, so you're going to get the Midnight Things songs. But I also will do anniversary tours where I'll do a full best of set, and I'll do those, and I've done those.
Mm-hmm.
And I have no problem with that either. That's fine. But if I have a new album out, I'm going to promote the new album, and then I'm hoping people love the new album more than they love the back catalog. So we'll see what happens. But it's just that's my way of thinking. It's always been that way. So.
Right, and it's got to be exciting too because you've kind of gone back home again with Metal Blade. Like, how does that feel to kind of be back there after, Like, this seems like a coming home kind of thing for you.
It is, and they've figured out how to do it, you know, because this music industry was so bad, it affected everybody, including them. But they crawled out from that collapse, and they figured out how to do it, and now they're more successful than they ever were. Uh-huh. And they figured out how to mesh it all together, and they work with everybody, managers, producers, directors, everybody, and that is something that labels usually never did.
Right.
You know, managers would deal with everything, and they would be the conduit to the label. But now this label is different. They actually are the conduit to everything, and that's why so many of their bands are top 10 bands. So, you know, when it came to time to making a new record on Metal Blade, I was like, okay, well, I like the new system. I couldn't possibly do an album with the old system, but with the new system, it actually is totally feasible to do it now. So so far it's been right. I mean, so far, everything that's been happening, we're having a wild party here at Hard Rock Live the night before the release, so it's going to be really, that's something really cool. We haven't had a release party, God, since Master of Disguise, I think.
Which has got to be so fun for you, because, again, like, it's not only is it kind of like a homecoming, but it must be kind of like a exciting time to be like, oh man, this is how I remember it, but like, it's happening again and it's feasible. It's not just, oh man, I'm putting out another record. You know what I mean? Like,
there's a huge celebration behind it, and the label loves the album too, which is a bonus, really. But yeah, I mean, we used to have wild release parties. We had one in the orchestra room at the Capitol Records. I think it was for the Visualize tour. And we had like 400 or 500 people, all industry people in there, and playing the record, and everyone's loving it. And it was such a great time. And we've done that for a lot of the records. We had great release parties. And so to have that happen again, it feels like old times. And this one's could be the biggest release party we've ever had, because we opened it to the public.
Right.
It's gonna be a cool celebration and a packed one. So I'm excited by it.
And they're also re-releasing "Love You to Pieces" and "Menace to Society." They're reissuing that on like new like colored vinyl and stuff. So that's gotta be kind of a cool thing to kind of be tying in, like, you know, this new album, but plus also kind of giving some of your classic stuff a new breath of life or something. How do you feel about that kind of coinciding together?
Well, the fact that vinyl is coming back in any ways is really interesting. I've never thought it would. And, you know, you go to any electronic store and they've got turntables stacked up to the ceiling. And I know so many young kids are playing vinyl, which it seems so cool, because that's really how you slow that down and really try to understand an album. And you know, you've got to go through the motions of getting the record, put it in there. You see the big cover, you look at it. So to have that come back is so cool. And they're going to do it with the whole back catalog. They're just going to do it slowly. So I think the next couple will come out towards the end of the year, probably.
So I wonder if they'll re-release the Betamax version of Murderous Metal Road Show.
I don't think they're going to go that far.
So I guess the other thing too is that I wanted to talk about with you is that, I mean, again, just the longevity of what you've been doing and how long you've been doing it. Like, what kept you going? Because, again, so many of you, I mean, not to harken back to the movie, but, like, you know, so, I mean, a lot of those bands never got as far as you did, and some of them got close and packed it in after so many years. But what was it that keeps that fire burning for you?
I think just because I love it. You know, I just love, touring the world. I mean, there's not one country that I dread going to. Uh-huh. I love them all. And every time I go to a new country, we went, like, on the last tour, we went to Russia and South Korea and a lot of places that we'd never gone before. So it's still always a new experience because I'm still exploring different places that we haven't played. And the reaction we get is very similar to a reaction we get from places we've played before. So that's even more interesting. And now that I'm recording again, I missed being a recording artist. So now I'm back doing that again, which is the other half of what I do. And so that's added so much fuel to the fire. That's why I signed a 3-album deal, and I'm chomping at the bit to start working on the next record, just because I'm so excited by it, you know.
Well, it's funny because, like, you know, by the time your album is coming out, like, it's already old to you because you've already started, like, working on the next one, you know. So you're like, I wish I could put out, like, this 3 albums at a time, you know.
Yeah, I take each album separately, so I like to put a little gap between the records because I want to clean the palette, and, you know, because now I'm going to be writing about something completely different.
Right.
So I've been dabbling with ideas and working on that, but, you know, I've got so many things going right now with Midnight Things, and I want to keep my focus on that. Otherwise, I'd probably be half done with the album right now.
Right. Well, so what can you tell me about the concept behind My Midnight Things? And without divulging too much, how it's going to coincide with how the live performance is going to tie into it.
Well, I mean, My Midnight Things, anyway, you know, everyone has their own interpretation of what I'm talking about. And that's what art is to me. You know, when you go, I think he's talking about this, or I think he's talking about that. I love that. So I don't want to say what was in my mind at the time. But to tell you the truth, there was multiple things in my mind.
Right.
The reason why I called it My Midnight Things. But as far as the show, yeah, it's going to tie in. All the songs are going to tie in together in some way, and I'm going to try and mix in some of the older songs as well, but we'll see what happens. I'm working on that now, and it's a struggle.
Well, so
also, you have to, you know, yeah, go ahead.
No, go ahead. You were saying.
No, I'm just saying that, if you're playing festivals or you're playing headline clubs or you're supporting another act, there's a different approach you need to do for each one, but I want to keep it the same show, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I do things. It's some festivals you're doing a 90-minute show, some festivals you're doing a 45-minute show. So, but yeah, I mean, the show will be heavily the imagery and everything will be involved. Will be My Midnight Things, you know. So, I'm working with special effects guys now. We're coming up with different things that work with the show. So we're at the very beginning stages of it right now.
That's what I was going to ask you, actually, is like what stage you were at as far as developing the show.
Yeah, I've developed a lot of it so far, and I like what's coming out. But now I'm starting to talk to my special effects guys, and they've heard the record and they're coming up with ideas too, and there's, you know, I'm already being kind of blown away. And I've talked to production guys as far as stage production, and they have come up with ideas on how to make this feasible to tour around the world. And so it, all that stuff is happening, but it's in the beginning stages of it right now.
So with you saying that, like, obviously we're going to hear the bulk of material from My Midnight Things, is there any, like, classic songs from the past that haven't been played in a while, or if ever, that you look back and you go, man, I would love to just pull that one out again, just, you know, just to do it?
Well, the songs off of Master of Disguise I like to play, but sometimes if you don't have the lights and you don't have the right thing, and that album was so theatrical,
mm-hmm.
that if you don't have the lights to work with you, it loses some of that. It works great on the album, but when you play it live, it doesn't give everything that it could give. So sometimes I omit some of those songs because we're playing a festival during the day. and I know I'm not going to get that theatrics. It's more of a sunny beach feel, you know. So it's a different ball game, you know. And I can't just bring down the sun. So you know, you can't force these things because they don't work that way. But there's a lot of songs. I mean, the first two albums were not hugely successful, so I play some of that stuff. But it's really Master of Disguise, and I love the songs on Deal with the Devil. I'd love to play more of them, especially Loving You is Murder. Loving You is Murder might make the show.
That's a great fucking song, man. That really is. Yeah, that's a great song.
That song was going to be the single off that album, but they decided not to do any videos or anything for that album. So, but that song probably will make the show, but we'll see. You know,
it's funny that you're talking about the video medium again, and a friend of mine and I were just talking about this a couple days ago. Was that, you know, for obviously MTV doesn't even exist anymore. Well, I mean, as we know it, it doesn't exist anymore, and you know, so for the longest time, videos just were just passe. They were useless. But with the popularity of YouTube, especially over the past few years, I've seen bands making incredible videos, you know, and so it's got to be cool to know that, like, you've got an audience and a medium, like, especially like with YouTube, but that you don't have to deal with all the political bullshit and bureaucracy of MTV to get it played. You can just put it out there and just be like, hey, here's my video, go watch it, you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean. We did a video for Master of Disguise called Love is a Crime, and Zack Snyder directed it, who directed Justice League and Superman and, you know, all these great movies. But he directed us when he was just a kid. You know, we were one of his first projects. But MTV rejected it because there was a woman running it, and she didn't want to see any more women in videos. Because there was, you know, everybody was using women in their videos, and she said, I'm done, and I'm starting with you, you know, and you know,
you had to be an example.
20 years later, this guy goes on to be one of the biggest directors in the movie industry, and his video was a great video. It was one that was probably at the time was the best video we had ever done, and it was one of his first things as a kid. So, you know, it's tragic that some woman or whoever could stop that progress of this budding director because she didn't want to see videos with women in them anymore. So, yeah, not having to deal with that, those kind of people, and those people that are just going to just stop things in your career or that just because they feel a certain way, it's just, you know, it's awesome. It's so freeing, you know. And, you know, the ratings for MTV were never that huge anyway.
Right.
And so now it's exposed to the world. So it's a...
Well, so much of MTV, too, back in the day was like, I mean, even though they would never discuss it and talk about it, but me and my buddies used to look back on it and be like, you know, it was totally payola. You know, like, whatever band was, or whatever label was fronting the most money, that their bands got played during the day, you know? Or, like, even in Headbangers Ball, that's why we always used to joke around and say that the best bands were played in the last 45 minutes of Headbangers Ball. You know what I mean? Because you're like, wow, that's some good shit. Like, I had to stay up really late to hear it, but, like, why aren't they being played first, you know? And so it's nice that, like you said, you have that power now and that kind of liberated freedom to just say, hey, you know, here's a video that we made. We made it the way, you know, I made it the way I wanted to make it. Here it is. Watch it. You like it? Love it. Don't watch it. You know?
Yeah. I mean, and if you knew how Headbangers Ball was run, you would just cry. I mean, I hosted it in one time, and it was run by a bunch of college students who didn't, number one, did not like the music and did not care about the show. They were just doing it for credits. And we came in for all these show ideas, and they just said, no, we just have you read the teleprompter, and that's it. Yeah. And it was the most unartistic people that I've ever met running that show. And that's why it became stale and boring, because it was run by people who didn't care, and they were not artistic in any way. So I was like, I walked out of there going, oh my God, this show it has such power to it, and it could be so fun and engaging, and instead it's run by people who don't care, and don't care about the music, don't care about the bands, have zero desire to be interesting in any way, and in fact, the more boring it was, what they actually wanted. And so it was that's when I just said, you know what, I don't care about being on this station anymore.
And, you know, and it doesn't surprise me, because looking back on it now, you know, like I said, like I just remember even being in high school and me and my friends watching Adam Curry when he hosted it, and we were like, why does he have a clipboard in his lap? Does he not know anything about these guys? Like, you know what I mean? So we were like, at least it got slightly interesting when Ricky Rackman took over and he was a metalhead and things like that. But there still was this kind of feeling that, like, that I wasn't really getting the good stuff. Do you know what I mean? That, I mean, I was getting good stuff, but that, you know, like all of the things, the really good stuff is the stuff you have to kind of dig and kind of find. And
well, it started out good. They had it was called Metal Mania, and Dee Snider hosted it.
Yeah,
and he was so interesting and so funny, and kept things. He talked a mile a minute, so you were never bored. You know, and he just took over the whole thing, and he should have taken over Headbangers Ball when they transitioned. But they didn't want to pay him. But he was the most interesting host. They need, you know, you need a very interesting host when you're doing a show every week, and you know the host is very important.
Right.
So if it's not interesting, it all falls on the artist. And most artists, like we talked about earlier, are musicians. So they're just going to come in and go, yeah, we played heavy on this album and it was good, you know. So
and you're like, I want to come out of a television.
Exactly.
It's like, where's my TV to bust out of? You mean you just want me to sit on this couch? That sucks.
Yeah, exactly. We came in there with props. We came in there with a whole bunch of different things, and they nixed it all. And I just said, well, you gotta be kidding me. You just want me to read the teleprompter? Yeah. We don't want you to be interesting at all. Just read the teleprompter.
We don't want you to be interesting at all. That's great.
Yeah, and I was just like, oh my God, this is just terrible. This is how you run this show. This is terrible.
Well, man, I couldn't be happier for you, because one of the things that I think I'm so excited to hear from you, especially being a fan for so many years, and like I said, you know, from 1986 to, you know, 2018, like, to hear you so excited about the present and the future, and to not be one of those that are so rooted in the past to where you're like hanging on, like, this is a really exciting thing for me. So, like, I have to give you kudos for that, because I think that's really pretty, you know, spectacular.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you. You know, the press has been so good about this record. I've never had the response that I've been getting from this record, from any record. So it's contagious. It's very, you know, when you're working on a record, you don't know what the response is going to be, and you just do it. Even the video that we just did, I didn't know. I mean, I saw the roughs and I was like, well, I don't know if people are going to like this or not, but so far everyone that's seen it is blown away by it. So I'm like, you know, okay, well, you know, you don't know until you get it, but it that kind of enthusiasm is contagious, and I'm loving just to be part of it.
I mean, but it really is. It's spreading from you, you know, because like I said, it's that Iron Maiden kind of mentality where, like, and I, you know, and what I mean by that is, like, every time Maiden puts out a new album, there is this level of excitement and almost not hype, but like the band is so pumped for it. And when they go out on the road, they do like half the album. You know what I mean? And like,
yeah,
they're super pumped about it. And so, like, it's, you can't help but be excited about something when the artist is that excited. So, like, I started out this interview today with you being excited to talk about, you know, 1986. And now I'm all excited about, dude, please make sure Atlanta's on the fucking tour date so you can come here so I can see this show. You know what I mean? So, like, just in the span of, you know, 50 minutes, I've already forgotten about the Murderous Metal Road show, and now I want to see this one, you know?
That's what I'm trying to do, really. I'm trying to you know, every time I put the show, a new show together, I feel it's the best show. It's better than the show we did before. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I constantly try and do that. And I'm going to put a lot into this show, and I'm hoping to bring it everywhere. Really, it's about fan support. It's about lots of different things, why we come to whatever territory. So, I'm excited to bring this show everywhere, including Atlanta.
So the release date of the album is June 15th, so we've got a little time between so now. When do you think you're going to launch the tour? Are you going to try to wait till maybe after the new year to launch this? Because this seems like it's going to be a pretty big haul for you.
Yeah, and that's what I, we're starting to think, as we're putting this together, we're thinking, could we do it? Could we? I love winter tours. I'm one of the crazy people who like it.
I actually like them too, man.
Yeah, there's a lot of musicians who hate it, but I absolutely love doing winter tours. And so I'm not opposed to starting it towards the end of the year, but we'll see. You know, the first thing first, get the album out, get the response from the fans, and then we go from there.
Yeah, well, I am super excited for you, and I'm super excited for the album and the video. And like I said, it was an honor to talk to you. And what a great dude, man! You're as nice as you were on the Metal Years. So that's all I can say.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, look, man. Well, good luck with the album and everything, and with the staging of the tour. And I'm hopefully going to look forward to seeing you here in Atlanta at the Masquerade, which still exists, by the way, but it's in a new location.
Wow.
Yes.
Unreal.
They actually just moved. They just moved about almost 2 years ago to a new location, because the old place, the old wooden place where you guys played, was has been bought out by like a big development. So, but they've got a much cooler room now. Like they've got still have the three rooms, but they're three different clubs in one little like courtyard kind of setup. And definitely gonna have room for you to put that show on. So
that sounds perfect.
We'll make it happen. I'm your guy. Okay. And I'll try to get in touch with the Black Crows and find out if they have your fucking costumes too. So
yeah, that's hysterical.
Well, Lizzy, thank you.
Turn them to me after all these years.
Chris Robinson probably wore them in like 95, and we just don't know about it.
Yeah, really.
they did have their little glammy period there for a little bit, so who knows, man? Maybe he was running around in some of your fucking fishnets or whatever, Who knows? But anyway, so... Well, thanks for taking the time to do this, man. It was a pleasure, and again, just best of luck to everything.
Thank you so much, man. I appreciate it. Appreciate talking to you, and we're going to bring the Midnight Things back to Atlanta. I'm sure of it.
Well, bring it everywhere. Bring it big, man.
That's the only way I know how.
All right, man. Well, you take care. Thanks a lot.
Okay, man.
All right. Bye-bye.